Your IQ will come around from green to brown, from up to down, from Stalingrad to Vegas. Hey, open up them pearly gates for Club Genius. Look out, hey, seven pillars of Club Genius. When I hear the word culture, I reach for my TV guy. I reach for my TV. I reach for Club Genius. The only place to be. Hey, Club Genius. The only show to see. Mary had a little lamb. Louisiana had food stamp fraud. And you got Club Genius. No cattle mutilations here. Club Genius. Advanced through the rear at Club Genius. Club Genius. Club Genius.
Jackie kind of guy, Rudy Cheeks.
What? No audience here? Hold on, just a minute. Let me see if we can. That's what we do when we don't have an audience here. Okay, well, welcome to Club Genius tonight. And if you're wondering why we're going on the air a little bit late this evening, well, that's because Ian, what a guy, just can't wait to get in that camera. The reason why we're going on the air a little bit late this evening is because we've had a little bit of problems with the guests. We've had guests been sick before. We have one of our guys who was supposed to be on the show tonight, Brian, has bone spurs or something like that. He's had injections in his foot. It's been terrible. He's had a terrible time. This seems to be plaguing, well, of course, Brian's the one who's really suffering, but the show is suffering too. This is just not the first time that this has happened. And that's not the first time that's happened with Ian either. He's just a little bit out of control. If you can hear Ian P. Tracy in the background there just screaming and yelling because he doesn't have his own show yet. Anyway, we've been having this problem. You know, people just calling in, not being able to make the show. It's a big problem. Last time this happened, Chip Young did this. Chip Young called me up, and he said, oh, I can't make it tonight, you know, at the last minute. Chip's a great guy, but, you know, I just, you know, Chip, well, he was supposed to be on tonight's show, too, I think, you know, and he called in sick again, and, you know, you know, sometimes you really wonder. You think that, you know, somebody said, oh, maybe he's just at home watching the Thornbirds or something like that. No way. No, I mean, that's a really stupid show. Nobody, I mean, Chip Young is a real smart guy. He's obviously, you know, listen, I'll tell you what. I'm going to give Chip a call right now, see what he's doing, because, see how he's feeling, because I know he's ill. He called in sick. Let me just go around to the desk here. Make a phone call to Chip Young, who's supposed to be on tonight's show. Let me see if we get his number here. Yeah, you can hear that out there in the studio. Let's see, Chip is. He was supposed to be on the show tonight, and he was sick at home.
Who is this?
Hi, Chip?
Yeah?
Chip, is this you?
Yeah.
How you feeling? This is Rudy Cheeks.
Oh, Rudy, fine. I'm sorry, I was just a little involved in something.
Yeah, I know. I know you've been ill, and how you feel? I mean, some idiot was telling me that, you know, what are you doing anyway?
Well, I was kind of ill. I don't know. I just not feeling so well, you know? I just,
What you doing at home? You watching the show, I guess, huh?
Well, yeah, I did kind of have the TV on, you know, because I was ill and in bed, and,
Do you like this red shirt I'm wearing? Are you watching something else on the television?
I guess I couldn't get it in tonight. Your show in.
That's what she said. What are you doing?
Well, I think the only station that was coming in was channel whatever has the Thornbirds on.
You're watching the Thornbirds.
Well, it's because it's the only thing I can get, I guess. you know, sort of like Barb Stanwyck was on the other night. It was kind of like Big Valley Down Under.
Yeah. And what is going on now? I have not been watching it, of course.
The only reason I'm watching is because it's the only thing I can get. But it's kind of they're stealing a lot of Margaret Mitchell's ideas. It's kind of like Gone with the Flame and Wind, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, right. Gone with the Wind.
And Richard Chamberlain is just pretending not to be a Nancy boy as usual. There has been a little visible panty line through the cassica, though. I have to admit that. But other than that, every time, you know, it's in Australia and there's a whole lot of big sheep scenes, and every time he appears, they all get nervous. I don't know.
Well, that sounds like an exciting show, but nowhere near as exciting as this. And
I'd be there, and if I wasn't sick, and I'd be watching if my TV must be broken, or something's wrong with the cable, I think. That must be it. It's all I can say. I mean, really, you know I'm a slave to your show.
You certainly are, and rightfully so. Okay, Chip, well, listen, have fun watching the Thornbirds, and...
Really, don't take this the wrong way.
Oh, okay, I won't.
Richard Chamberlain wouldn't either.
Okay, that proves it, okay? Just, I'll see you later.
Okay, thanks.
Bye,
I'll get
Chip.
Back to it.
Yeah. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
There you go. I mean, this guy is just home watching the Thorn... Just go to a commercial. I don't even want to talk about it. We've got a show. We've got a great show tonight. But just go. For you people who are wondering exactly what's going on here this evening, apparently we're picking up the soundtrack from MTV over here, and it's just insinuated its way onto our commercials. It's just, I can't believe it. But anyway, be that as it may, tonight is Culture Night on Club Genius, and we have a number of cultural events, a classical mime, classical singing, and right now we'd like to have a little classical contest for you folks out there, another call-in contest. Get a chance to call in and answer this. Call in is one of the guys in the studio. I don't know, this phone here is hooked up. I'm afraid we're going to get some problems, some ringing phones. But we have a question right now having to do with the plays of Shakespeare. Now, I'm going to name off five plays. Four of them are actual plays of Shakespeare's. One of them is not. And you're just going to have to call in and give the answer to this question, the play that is not a play of Shakespeare's. Now, here's the list of plays. As You Like It, that's one. Macbeth, two. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, that's three. Merchant of Venice, that's four. And King Henry IV, part two, number five. Let's go over them once again. Number one, As You Like It. Number two, Macbeth. Number three, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Number four, Merchant of Venice. And number five, King Henry IV, Part Two. We try to keep these real simple for you out there. So if you can call them, we're going to flash the number right here on the screen. Call the number and speak with one of our official producer type guys in this contest. See, there you go. And I knew this was going to happen. We've got somebody right here on the phone. I wonder. UFOs. Isn't that, no, that's a isn't it? Is it going to stop ringing? I guess so. Okay, that's what happens when you get the phone hooked up out here. You see, nothing ever goes right here on Club Genius. Anyway, we're going to try to see if we get a winner in there. If these guys have cleared the phone calls to make sure no one's yelling, screaming, cursing. This happens sometimes here. We've been victimized with this before. Have we got a winner in there, guys? He cut somebody off. Then apparently somebody was speaking in a foreign language.
Yeah, we've got a winner.
We've got a winner?
Yeah.
Who is that winner, Tom?
No.
All right, let's see if this is the winner here. Shall we? Should I? Should I dare? No, I'm not going to. I just don't want to touch it. Okay.
Is this the winner?
Yeah.
What's your name?
Sharon.
What?
Sharon, you know, Sharon.
Sharon.
Yeah.
Okay, hold on, Sharon. Yeah.
Okay.
Is this a winner?
This is a winner.
What's your name?
Johnny O.
Johnny O. What do you say? What's the answer?
Claude Rains.
Claude Rains. I'm sorry, you're a loser.
He didn't get it right. These people apparently weren't even, they must have been listening to a radio talkback show or something like that and thought that they were calling in there. Okay, we do have one. Does Sharon get the right answer? Oh, what a mess this is. I don't know. Listen, we're going to take a break. I'll deal with the phones. We're going to take a break now, and then we'll deal with the phones when we come back, okay? Take a break. What? Is this a winner or a loser or what? Okay, we are back, and Sharon indeed was the winner. Sharon Terzian wins absolutely nothing, but she was right. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly was not written by Shakespeare.
And Rudy Cheeks, here I come.
Oh, okay, well, here it looks like we, what a guy. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Hercules. What an honor, Hercules. Garofalo is here with us right now. Herc, how you doing?
Good, Rudy.
Yeah?
Nice to see you.
Good to see you, too. This is a beautiful outfit. How long have you had that?
3 months, 2 or 3 months.
2 or 3 months?
Couple of months, anyway.
Yeah, speak right into the microphone.
Couple of months, Rudy.
Okay, that's the way to go. That's the way to go. Now, Herc, I don't know if some of the people out there know about you. Hercules Garofalo, of course, great opera star. A gorilla opera star, actually. And Herc, tell me a little bit about your career. The famous incident on top of the water tower.
On the tank.
Right.
I sang for the whole world for 9 hours.
Sang for the whole world, and how far away did they hear you singing?
Lady of Fatima Hospital, which is about 4 miles, 3.5, 4 miles away.
Yeah, and you weren't wearing that outfit though when you did this.
No.
This is a new outfit, right?
Well, when I was up there, I got the word to make it.
You get the idea that this is a beautiful thing, too. I think you could branch right into wrestling with an outfit like that, to tell you the truth. If you never thought of wrestling.
They'd tear it apart on me.
They'd tear it apart.
Well, now, months of making it, right?
Oh, yeah, it is. It is kind of nice material here. Jeez, it's beautiful. Who made this?
A combination of myself and, I put the stones and stuff
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, that's a lot of work.
A woman friend of mine and my aunt helped out on it.
Mm. It's beautiful. Now, what have you been up to? I heard you did something at Zaire's just the other week.
Well, I was down there a couple of weeks ago, and they had the grand opening, and he told my friend Rich, he said, geez, Rick should come over. So he came over and I put everything on. I went over and said, I didn't think you'd be here. So I set my truck up as a little float and I would sing it to everybody.
Right, and this is the Zaire's where? And what's
Hartford Avenue.
Hartford Avenue, right.
So the people were going by in 295, they could see me glittering. So when they got home, they called up, what's going on there, you know?
So you got a big crowd, huh?
Yeah, and these lights are hot, too.
Now, how'd you first get interested in opera? How long have you been singing?
I'll tell you, I've been singing since the Second World War.
Tells me plenty.
Way back.
When you were a boy.
Young boy. Probably before I can even remember. Before I could walk, really. Because I was a late walker. My mother told me it took me 18 months to walk.
And were other people in the family, did they sing or did you have records?
My father sings and my whole family sang. In fact, they used to do the quartet from Rigoletto. The whole family would get together. And I had an uncle that was Martino Rossi, was with different opera companies.
Mm-hmm. Now, did you ever get into formally join an opera company or anything like that?
Oh, no. I had chances, but I just, for some reason, something always held me back.
Yeah, you let them go. But I think that's because you now realize that this is your true calling, to bring opera as a popular entertainment form to the people, right?
Bring it right to street level, right down. The way I am, the way I enjoy it, I want the people to enjoy it.
The way I see that outfit right now, that's definitely street level. I don't know what street. I'm not going to name the street.
Sesame, right?
Sesame Street. That could be true. Anyway, you were talking about a little earlier on, you wanted to do a bit from a famous opera, right?
Oh, you mean do it live now?
We're talking about doing something live, yeah. I mean, we really don't. Please. And over here on the set, we can use it over on the set there. I know. This is, what opera is this? Can we...
this would be Othello. We're talking about
Othello, right. Othello. Talking about Shakespeare just earlier, and this is from a Shakespearean play.
Yeah, I can just give you the end of it a little bit.
Right.
The very last act of Othello.
And Othello is, who wrote the opera? This was
Giuseppe Verdi.
Verdi. This is a Verdi opera.
And the libretto was by a fellow named Boito. Boito, who was a composer himself. But him and Verdi got together and put on this big spectacle, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We worked on it for a few years.
And of course, this scene that we're going to see, what exactly is going on so the people will know who don't speak Italian?
Well, what's going on is...
Such as myself.
As simple as this, he choked his wife for no reason.
What a guy.
What a guy. And he finds out that they come running into the room after he suffocated her, I don't know what close to it. She's dead for nothing. She's dead for nothing, anyway.
Mm.
And he turns away from everybody. See, she thought there's him was cheating with the younger fellow, because Othello was in his 50s, and his wife, I guess, would be anywhere from 28 to like 31, 32 in that area.
Mm-hmm.
So she was supposed to have been in love with this Cassio. Mm-hmm. Now, Iago was the villain. There's a lot of Iagos. Iago was the one that put...
Iago Sangria, I'm familiar with
that. And he put the thought in Othello's head.
We're going to want you to put the mic on the stand for your speech,
okay? We are now going to do a brief scene. Myself and Hercules Garofalo are going to do a brief scene from Othello. Now, I play Desdemona in this scene, so I have my official Desdemona hat here. Let me see if I can... Here it is. This is just a little wig put together by our beautiful crew here. How's that look? Pretty good?
Lovely.
Oh, thank you very much. And we're going to go over here and perform this actual scene from the... I don't think Hercules is going to need this mic, to tell you the truth. He can take this from a distance. Okay, here we go. Let me get this straight over here. Now, I've just been choked. Is that the idea?
Well, I guess I put the pillow over your face.
Okay, let's see. Oh, you want to put this pillow over my face?
No.
That's just, okay. I'm kind of out like this, huh? Let me see if I can take these wires out. Okay.
So you're going to back.
Am I dead or just kind of dead?
Morta.
Okay, Gonzo.
Io mi tema, san coronato mi vede, ecco la fine del mio cammino. Othello fu. You're dead.
Oh.
That's just the music.
Et tu, come se pallido, e stanca, e muta, e bella.
I get the idea. I get the lousy roll in this. That's it. That's it. I'm not dead any.
I don't have the dagger.
I'm very glad you don't have the dagger either, Herc. Holy cow. What an unbelievable. Hercules Garofalo. What a guy. That's beautiful work there. Thank you very much. I know a lot of opera fans out there in the viewing area loved this. This was folks, so we're using the tape overtime. Let me get rid of this foolish hat. There was Hercules Garofalo. Hercules, amazing, amazing performer, and probably coming to your neighborhood soon. Our next guest now is right here with me, Michael Grando, noted international mime artist. Of course, Michael's done The Tonight Show many times. He's been on Saturday Night Live, I believe. He's done off-Broadway, been all over, done just about everything, a tremendous performer right here on our show. And Michael, apparently that's not you, is it? That's kind of cardboard.
That's a representation of me, Rudy.
Well, Michael, you're a mime artist, and you don't speak, do you?
No, I tell you, I'm highly trained, of course, as a Shakespearean. And when I began my career, they told me I was a little too tall for Shakespeare, so I took up the silent work instead of the word acting.
I always did wonder what drew you to mime, Michael, and
well,
I think
you know, I do have a fantastic speaking voice which can't project to the back of any auditorium, so I couldn't understand why they want me to do something nonverbal.
Yeah, it's interesting because you know, I always assumed that I didn't know what really drew you to it, but now I think I'm starting to get the picture really exactly why you have preferred a silent art form.
Well, I can't attempt being funny. I mean, this is my real voice, that's true. I have the mask, this mask, in front of my other mask because of the ancient classical tradition of mime, which dictates if you're in makeup, you can't speak. But I, you know, if I'm with you, Rudy, I have to speak. I've been a fan of yours for years, too.
Well, Michael, we've known each other for a long time, and I'll have to admit now, this voice I'm using is phony. And this is really the way I speak.
That's
I know
right.
That it's a lot of people never knew that, but this is my real voice, and I've been using this phony one for a long time just to get by.
I noticed that when I nod my head in agreement with you, my mask stands still. Actually, I should be doing this, I suppose.
But you can't think of everything, really.
No, but I really do thank you for the opportunity to come. I noticed the set looks absolutely smashingly great. I love the things. I mean, it's my first visit to
Club Genius,
and I hope it becomes a regular thing for me. I've just returned from the White House. As a matter of fact, this particular piece of material we're going to do this evening was something that I did for the Reagans recently in Washington.
Oh, great. Well, you know, we've got a high culture show. Like I said, we did this Othello piece. We've done the Shakespeare quiz, and I'm really glad that we have something like, you know, an ancient art form like mime. We're going to see a great classical piece. That is this a piece that's been in your repertoire for a while?
I'm sorry to interrupt you. This piece is a marvelous piece. I think really it's the first time a Western classic mime in this century has really made a consistent effort to delve back into the history of theater and direct something of this nature, of this caliber. This particular piece is, of course, from the Commedia dell'arte, the 14th, 15th century in Italy. Probably it has its birth in Milan or someplace like that, you know. In those days, it labored under a different title, but today, of course, it's called But It's Not. And it's a rather formal and beautiful lyrical piece that I think should set the toast to tapping out there in TV land.
Well, this is it, folks. Silent television, and now we're going to have Michael unclip himself and go over and prepare himself over in our performance area. Maybe if we could take that beanbag chair out of the way for just a second, and we will have Michael Grando performing in Well, It's Not. Is that the...
But
It's Not. But It's Not. Michael Grando, international mime artist. Well, that was beautiful, Michael. Let me say this: the high culture, the kind of taste and class you get with high culture, it's just.
Oh, I tell you, it's breathtaking, Rudy. I know when the Reagans saw that, their noses started to run.
Yeah.
I saw Ronnie; his arm was right up there.
That was the only thing that ran. Just.
Ooh,
the nose.
I want to tell you, yeah. Boy, the whole Supreme Court, they were in there. They could prove. They were just like me, common, regular fella.
Right up to the
elbow,
though.
You know how the
Three
Stooges are when they throw those pies?
Yeah.
Man, when they let those knots go, oh, the robes turn real weird colors. Washington will never be the same. They're all stuck to their chairs. Next bank would probably beg him to come over with a putty knife and pry him loose.
Okay, well, I also want to point out here, if we can get a little close shot over here of me, I'm wearing this beautiful piece of jewelry. Michael, maybe you can tell us a little bit about this jewelry, because this is some work. Where are we here now? They're not.
Oh, yeah, that's.
If we can zoom in on this piece right
these
here.
These are art galleries on your body, folks. These are made by a crazy little person called Panatella Grande Designs in a state called, hey, is this real? Rhode Island.
Hey, this
it's
is it right
of mine.
Here.
Right there, that little rhinoceros, or excuse me, I think that's a Tyrannosaurus Rex, is about to eat a film producer, I think, there.
Is that this?
Yeah, it looks like Sylvester Stallone.
It could be, and I can, and I don't think I can't think of another film producer that's more worthy of being eaten
well,
alive.
Well, if you're going to eat flesh and blood, eat strong flesh and blood.
Well, Michael brought me this beautiful pin tonight, and I want to thank him for that. This pin from Panatella Grande, and I want to thank Michael Grande.
Hey, my pleasure.
Here. Michael, it was great having you, and we're gonna go for a break right now, and we'll be back. We'll be back after this message of public interest.
There's a line there waiting to blow their nose. They tell me.
Should be cares about this state. He was born here, and he knows the land and the people in a way that only one who cares about Rhode Island can. Rudy Cheeks cares about the environment. He cares about the handicapped. He cares about the family. Rudy Cheeks cares about the threat of nuclear proliferation.
Hi, I'm Rudy Cheeks, and I'm not running for political office or anything. I just thought you might be interested in what I care about. I also care about
washing machines, weird mannequin parts, locusts, the Everly Brothers, and what they're doing today.
Rudy Cheeks, he cares about almost everything.
Okay, are we back? We're back, ladies and gentlemen, back here at Club Genius, and I'd like to thank Michael Grando and, of course, Hercules Garofalo, and now another great artist. We're talking about, like, the classics in art today. We have Sandor Bodo. Sandor, nice to see you.
How are you, Rudy?
And Sandor, you're a photographer and filmmaker, right?
That's right.
Based right.
Cameras and things like that, too.
Right, basically, the first time I met you, you were doing 3D art, which is exactly what is that?
Well, that's using the illusion of stereoptics, which basically means you take two photographs from a spatially separated, separated by a little bit of space, and when you remix them with using one technique or another, you perceive a three-dimensional effect.
Right, such as the old...
Short story long. Right. The stereopticons or the Viewmasters or...
Sometimes just your eyes. You just fuse your eyes together with photos and that kind of a thing, right?
Or in real life, for example.
Real life. I tried to fuse my eyes and ended up just fusing my brain. And tonight, this is... You have an exhibit coming up, don't you, of three-dimensional... photography.
Well, that's still. I don't know if I can talk about that.
Okay, well, we can't talk about that. I'm awfully sorry. We can't talk about that.
I don't have any of the facts or figures.
Okay, and of course, as we all know, figures are a little bit more important than the facts. But what we do have tonight are some Super 8 films that you've made. Now, what exactly are these? I'd like to. What kind of films are they? When did you make these? Give me some information on them.
Well. They were made about a year ago, and you're going to see a variety. They're quite short, about 3-4 minutes long. They're visual sort of experiments using different sort of things. You probably have better questions after you see them.
Okay. Do we have any musical accompaniment for this?
There is musical accompaniment. I think Bob has it all queued
Bob's
up.
Bob's all queued up in there with the musical accompaniment so we'll go right now and take a look at these films. Films by Sandor Bodo. Sandor, scene over here in the monitor, and you can...
Am I still mic'd up?
Yeah.
Okay.
We should... Oh, hold on. I think they'll be doing the sound from there, so maybe they won't be able to hear us. I'm not sure.
First film here, Telefunken, it's basically taking, it's actually interesting to see it back on video again, but it's, I'm using a color TV set as my image and filming off of it and doing various homegrown film effects to the image. It's right off, right in my own living room. And I'm using various different little frills and thrills in my camera supplies, but basically, in all the films, the first three films you're going to see, I'm using a time-lapse feature mixed with long individual exposures, and what I'm doing with that is a light drawing. I'm basically working with light drawing in a film format, and what all that means is basically that in each frame of the film, the image is exposed for much longer than normal, more like about 10 seconds or so, and then I'm doing things like panning, tilting, and zooming and things like that. And when you do that past a TV image, since it's a recycling image, the screen unsprings. You have a sort of a moiré pattern. There's a variety of different kinds of visual images.
Yeah, and this is still all TV, huh?
Yeah, it's all TV.
Sometimes late at night, that's what I seem to be getting off my TV too.
I think Chip's TV is like that.
Yeah, Chip's TV comes in like that. Yeah, especially when he's trying to watch. I hope it comes in like this tonight while he's watching the Thornbirds. It's a disgrace. I'm trying to see if I can see any familiar images here. I'm not getting a real good...
Probably the news.
The news here, local news people. Is that McGee Hickey, I thought I just...
No, I think...
Famous local news figure?
It might be Art Blake or somebody there.
Yeah, it looks like a weather map. Actually, the music kind of sounds like the kind of music you'd run before the news on some really hyperactive station. Okay, I think we got a different film coming on now, right? And we're going to change the soundtrack maybe, huh?
No, the sound continues on.
The sound continues on.
Except where the sound is lagging behind the picture, but that's all right.
I see. Oh, so we get a little shift. It's all kind of queued up, huh?
It's kind of somethinged up.
Yeah.
Sort of queued up.
And this is...
This is a film called Nightcar, which is using the same light drawing effect. Long exposures per each of the time-lapse images. So there's a light drawing with an effect which will increase through the film. Oh, I'm supposed to mention these are award winners.
Oh, where were these? Award did these win?
The Rhode Island Film and Video, the Community Awards. The amateur division, which means I paid for it.
Right. Well, are you going to move into the professional division so they can pay for it next time? I hope so.
Hey.
Sander, you fool. You fool.
The only problem is when they want to pay for it, they want to pay for something else.
Like they don't want to pay for the film, they want to... Don't know what that means. Is this still the car you're driving?
Yeah.
I don't recognize it. That's because I see you on the bus, that's why.
I must be.
You're a bus kind of guy like me.
I only have a car just to do this. I went and expressly bought a car.
Right, it doesn't actually run or anything, just the radio works and that's it.
Yeah, the heater.
That's good, because I know a lot of people would probably like to move into that car. Really, you've been living in cardboard boxes the last few years, and it's getting rough out there. It's getting rough. And what is the music we're listening to, by the way?
Oh, the music in this particular piece was composed by my brother,
uh-huh.
Laszlo Bodo. And I forget who the woman, the soprano voice singing is. I apologize for that. And there's one more film after this, which you might get a kick out of. Oh, let's see. Back here.
Oh, we're back on. Hold on. Caught in the act of watching the film. Whoa. Okay, what's the story here? We're running out of time here, and we're going to... Okay. Okay, well, that was beautiful. And you mentioned your brother did the music for that. He's a musician?
He's a musician down in Memphis.
Memphis?
Down in Elvis country. That's right.
Yeah, and what kind of work
does he do? He's got a southern accent, everything. Well, he actually worked for a cable TV station. What a big surprise.
He works for a cable TV
station?
Well,
he doesn't now. He used to. Now he works as a photographer
money,
at a hospital. That's right.
He worked for a hospital.
He works as a photographer in a hospital.
I see. So basically music is just one of many things he does. It's not necessarily his primary vocation.
yes, as in with many of us, it's not.
Right. How can
it's a thing that we spend money on rather than it spends money on us.
Yeah. Well, those are tremendous. And have you continued to make some films?
Yeah. I'm working on something right now which is a bit more normal than my last efforts, but fun nonetheless. I'm doing a time-lapse portrait of Providence. Mm-hmm. Lots of different scenes,
Always
busy activity and lights going around buildings and ominous shadows. And
what you would do there is like set up your camera in the same spot every day or something like that, or every week.
No, it'd be one during the day.
So a day long time lapse type thing.
Right, and some of them even shorter, depending on the kinds of activities, like rush hour, clogging up or parking lots, cramming
right,
full of cars and that sort of thing.
Yeah, I was, what was I going to say? I can't even think. I've really lost it. I've lost the thought. I've lost my mind. Who knows? Well, Sando, that was beautiful, and I'd love to see the next. We're going to see this third film. This is great. Okay, because I did want to see it, but I was being told by the folks in the booth that we didn't have enough time. So let's take a look at this third film. And this is,
okay.
Which one is this one, Sando?
This one will be called Wooly Bully.
Wooly Bully.
Wooly Bully. Oops, it's already in progress. No music.
No music.
Okay,
for this
well,
one,
let's
so.
See. I can talk. I could whistle. Let it go.
Maybe they're getting some music now. I don't know, but.
I missed the intro on it. Keep my mic on. Hello.
Oh, I'm trying to keep it.
This, speaking of light drawing,
uh-huh.
This really is a light drawing in much more the traditional way than the other two. where in fact I have my camera set up with the time lapse and the lengthened exposure for each frame. And I was sort of messing around with some flashlights one evening.
I see. So this is a flashlight effect.
Flashlights. Yeah.
Flashing. And how do you get something like that box and the circle type things? That just a quick.
I just repeat them. Repeat the drawings. Here is Christmas lights. Playing with a string of Christmas lights, which gives a sort of geometrical pattern. But it's something that's controllable but tiring. Not the Christmas lights, but actually drawing consistent shapes.
Yeah, yeah. I take it that this is your apartment and not your $1 million studio.
Right, no, this is inside of my car, actually. No,
oh, well, this is beautiful, the back seat, I take it, yeah. Mm. You could live in there.
Just about.
It's the famous accordion shape there, yeah. She actually, you could do a little lariat type thing here. I don't want to blow anything. Maybe that's coming up. I don't know, like a little.
It's the climax. You've ruined the film.
Oh, I'm sorry, Sander.
I'm going home now.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do that. I just kind of was thinking if I were doing this, maybe that's what I would do. There it is. That's.
Oh, okay.
That looks more like the end. Okay. A Bodo film. Okay. Those people want to write to Sander. See, that's the proper spelling of his name there, B-O-D-O, Bodo. Is that, what ethnic origin is that?
That's Hungarian.
Hungarian.
Right.
And, gee, that's, why do I not care?
It's not shortened or anything. Why don't
Bodo, it's just, I don't know why, but Bodo, it's an interesting name, and you don't get a whole lot of...
It's too easy to believe.
Do many Hungarians change their names?
Let's see. Tony Curtis.
Tony Curtis, right. He used to be Tony Bodo.
That's right.
A lot of people don't know that. And once he got in those tights, that was it. He went Hollywood and changed his name to Tony Curtis. Well, anyway, Sander, it was great having you on here. And the films were tremendous. And I believe right now we're going to go to a tape, aren't we? We're not going to do anything.
No, we made time.
You mean what we're doing nothing? Yeah, but I know. But the show, we've still got another 10 minutes in the show.
We're not going to give him 10.
You're not going to do that.
We're doing the next thing.
You're going to do the next thing. Oh, okay. Well, that means that we're going to do. What? You're going to come on.
Yeah.
Tom's going to come on now.
No.
Hey, this is exciting. Tom is coming on, and then and Sandor's going to leave. Is that?
If you can just stay up there, you can move over.
If you want to move over into the Ed McMahon type seat over there, Sandor, and
yes.
And Tom, our producer's coming up here, who is obviously in the habit of this, of making this show even sloppier than we originally planned. I mean, you know, we knew it would be a sloppy show, but gee, we're going beyond that even tonight, I think. Tom,
well,
what's
we had a choice of doing Gimme 10, which was real nice, or seeing Super 8 films, and we thought that would be a good idea.
Well, I agree. I'm glad. I did want to see that last film, and I'm glad we did too.
Yeah.
So. But
we got a problem here because today, as you know, is payday.
Payday, right?
We kind of get paid, and
you'd never know it.
Problem?
Yeah, and I just received this memorandum, and it kind of kind of explains how there's no pay and there's no money, and I know. I think it just kind of sums up what cable TV all about.
Gee, I can't believe this. And I think it's really very, very interesting and entertaining that you come out here, Tom, and we do this right here on the air. I think that's entertainment. That's the way I like to put it right now.
Yeah.
And this seems to indicate to me that indicates to me that there's obviously no money coming for Club Genius. Club Genius once again working at a deficit.
So I just had a meeting with the general manager and got kind of depressed. And of course, Arthur Lisi was there and recorded it. And I think we have that down. I don't know.
We have it.
It just kind of sums up how we all feel about cable TV.
Oh boy, have
we
got
seen Super 8 films and how much better film is than cable. But
well, this is exciting. This is certainly thank you.
Johnson. By which success is a dead end street. I'll say it again. Cable TV is a concept by which success is a dead end street. Yeah. I don't believe in public access. I don't believe in local origination. I don't believe in CCN. I don't believe in Atlanta. I don't believe in preview. I don't believe in movie time. I don't believe in Starcase. I don't believe in HBO. I don't believe in MTV. I don't believe in Ted Turner. I don't believe in community involvement. I don't believe in Cinemax. I don't believe in ESPN. I don't believe in cable. Just believe in me. Network TV and me. And that's reality. The cable dream is over. What can I say? The cable dream is over. Satellites all the way. I was the producer, but now I'm Tom. I was the dream lord, but now I'm bored. And so, dear friends, you'll just have to watch reruns. The cable dream is over.
Well, folks, good night from everybody here at Club Genius. Get this. Thank you.